Recording. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. So what we have here to begin with is just a short introduction talking about renewable energy in general, after which we are going to come up with a little bit more focus into the basic principles which are related to solar energy. And by these basic principles, basically, I mean the orientation. I mean, in nutshell, we're discussing, for example, how much of the solar energy we expect to reach us at any time and at any orientation. So that's basically what we need to come up from the second part. The first part is nothing but just a little sort of introduction to the renewable energy in general, in which part of it you have already discussed. I mean, we have already covered with Dr. Buchheimer the issue of geothermal energy. But it will be some sort of a nutshell where we are talking about what are the different elements of renewable energy in general. So by renewable, we mean that they are remaining always there, they are sustainable, they are not depleted, theoretically speaking. The types that we are talking about, why I'm saying theoretically speaking, because you have seen with Dr. Naqvi that nuclear energy, which is sometimes looked at as a renewable energy, maybe in the sense that there's no emissions, I mean, gas emissions, particularly CO2, CO and hydrocarbons are going to the atmosphere, but is the quantity of uranium as a fuel, for example, are extending forever? That's another issue that that we're not sure about. But the renewable here, I mean, something that's like the solar energy, as long as there is a world, there is sun which is shining every day. Because of solar energy is there, it creates areas of high temperatures and areas of low temperatures on the atmosphere. This difference in high temperature and low temperature is driving the wind. Accordingly, there's wind energy. Biomass energy, basically, the main thing that we're interested in is wood. As long as there are forests, then there is wood and there is a source of energy. As long as there is tidal power and are rivers, then there is a energy coming, which is hydro energy. In addition to the Earth's heat, which is basically a geothermal source of energy. So in that sense, these are looked at as renewable or sustainable source of energies. As I mentioned a while ago, that most of them are originating from the solar energy. So solar energy is a main source of generating the solar heat from the sun, in addition to helping in maintaining our lives, our planet's lives. So that's about what has been stated as the biomass and the wind energy, the tides, and so on. The solar energy, as of talking the direct heat coming from the sun, one of the classifications is looked at whether it is passive or negative. Passive, it means that you did not do anything particularly other than having a glass window, and you are putting in the orientation of the solar energy to get heating, direct heating from the sun. In many, many places in US and Europe, they have rooms in the houses, they call it solar rooms or sun rooms. The sun room is nothing but a place which is having glasses that covering most of it, so that they make use of the sun when it rises and they go and sit in that room so that they can get some warmth without having to pay for it. So that's something that probably I've seen in many, many places in cold countries that are making use of the solar energy passively without having to use any systems associated with that. On the other hand, talking about this is what you see here is a figure that represents the passive solar energy. There's a house here, and the windows are there. The windows are helping in having the solar energy passing through it. Actually, the windows are having some sort of a surface property, which is related to what we call the greenhouse effect. So that glass basically is a material that can pass the short wavelength radiation. Short wavelength, I mean the radiation associated with short, smaller wavelengths, short, high frequencies, and accordingly, they can penetrate through the glass. Meanwhile, the glass cannot pass the long wavelength radiation, which are associated with low temperature. This is why if you are leaving your car in the sun while you are at work and you come back in the hot season, you cannot touch the steering wheel because it has accumulated all the heat inside. And this is basically some utilization of the greenhouse effect. It can be positively utilized, like in this case of heating. We can utilize it for water desalination or water purification applications. And sometimes you don't need it, like in our country here. And you have to leave a little bit of the window open or just put your car in a shaded place to avoid the very high temperature that can be accumulated inside. So this is sort of passive solar energy that I'm talking about. Active solar energy, this is where you have a device which is intended to make use, to make use of the energy in a direct form. You are talking about a solar collector. This solar collector can make use of the solar. Yes,
sorry, for the passive solar. I understood that in the winter it will give heat. But how in the summer it will cool? I think I read in the slide that it will cool the...
Yeah, that's an, I'll be talking about that. I mean, in one of the coming couple of slides that I'm talking about, how we can make use of the energy, solar energy, to cool down or to use it for cooling. And this is basically some sort of an active system because solar is given heat. So to use it to do something else, then that's something that is active, which means that you need to use a device.
Yes, you need to do something good. Make use of passive, in the passive, can we do it? Because I read it even in the
No, in the passive here, what you have to do basically is just if you have shades to protect your place, if it's too hot, then this is going to reduce the amount of energy coming into it.
Ah, okay.
Otherwise, it is just energy coming in.
Okay.
Now, if we are talking about a solar collector in which a surface is being painted in black, and the reason of painting in black is that you increase what we call the absorptivity of the solar energy, and then the surface gets heated, you pass water or air or any other fluid by the hot surface, it will be transferring the heat by convection. The surface is going to be heated. You can take the heat of that fluid, you circulate it inside a house, and then you exchange heat by drawing air through it, and then air will be heated, giving you enough warmth in the house, or it can be done for heating water or water heating or any other application. So the point is you are bringing a device. This device transmits the energy coming from the sun into positive energy coming to you in a building, and this is how you can make heating of either the space or water or whatever application that you are looking for and you need high temperature. This is an example here. The right-hand side is the active, left-hand side is the passive. The passive, there's nothing there. It's just you are putting a window to receive the energy coming from the sun. For the active one here, you have a solar heater on the top, water solar heater on the top, where basically inside this small cycle, what the sun is heating the fluid inside these pipes. The fluid could be water or it could be ethylene glycol, because in cold weathers, you didn't, if the temperatures are going below zero, you don't need this water to be freezing. So you put ethylene glycol so that it will not freeze at these temperatures, and then you are heating it. The hot fluid is going to go through a heat exchanger or a tank, where it will be heating the water inside the tank, and the water inside the tank, for example, can be extracted, or the heat exchanger can be outside the tank. The tank can be only for storage, and the hot fluid here is exchanging heat with water, and the water can be circulated throughout the whole house for heating. So this is some sort of an active application versus the passive application with nothing to do but just put a window and wait for the sun to heat. This is an example of a solar chiller. Now, the point here is, in refrigeration or air conditioning systems, we used to the idea of having a vapor compression system so that you have initially, let's put it that way, you have a system where an evaporator is there. In an evaporator, you are basically receiving very cold refrigerant, Freon, for example, coming in. This refrigerant is receiving heat from the surrounding, and hence it is cooling the surrounding by taking the heat off. The refrigerant itself is going to be heated, it will be evaporated, and then the vapor here, we need to bring it back again here. To bring it back again here, it means that we need to condense it. We cannot condense it at low temperature. So we have to use a compressor to compress it to high temperature, higher than the atmospheric temperature. So the atmospheric air would be enough to condense it. Now you have a liquid at high pressure and temperature, you pass it by an expansion valve, and then it will be liquid at low temperature, you pass it back again to the evaporator. So in that system, there's a compressor. Compressors, as we have seen in our basics of thermodynamics, are energy consumers because you are compressing vapor. The vapor is having substantially high specific volume. If you remember the equation that we have written earlier, that work is equal to the integral or specific volume into the pressure difference. The specific volume of vapor, for example, water vapor, have a specific volume of 0.1 to 1, whereas the specific volume of liquid water is 0.001. So as if you are dividing by 1,000, here comes the idea, why should I use a vapor compressor that's going to consume a lot of energy, whereas I can do something else? What is that? That something else is that you take the water vapor and you absorb it in a fluid. Then you pump the fluid by a pump. A pump would definitely need much less power than a compressor. And then when you pump it, you need to regenerate it back, or you need to separate the water vapor from that liquid. Basically, the liquid solution is something like lithium chloride, lithium bromide, or calcium chloride. What you do, you pass the water vapor, which is the refrigerant in this case, by lithium bromide. It will absorb it all, and you have a dilute solution of lithium bromide. You put it into a pump. When you put it into a pump, you pump it to very high pressure and temperature, relatively speaking. And then you need to separate the water from that lithium bromide solution. So you heat it. How do you heat it? Using solar energy. So this is how the solar energy can contribute into that cooling problem or the cooling system. You don't need a compressor. You replace it by a pump. This pump is pumping a solution of a desiccant. A desiccant is basically an air dryer, or it is a solution that absorbs the water energy. So you absorb water vapor, and then this solution that has the absorbed water vapor is going to be heated to high temperature and high pressure. And then you heat it by solar energy. By heating it, what will happen? The water vapor is going to be liberated. So you are having now water vapor at high pressure and temperature. Then you pass it through the expansion valve. It will expand to low pressure and temperature, and then the cycle is being repeated. So this is how the solar energy can contribute into what we call an absorption chiller.
Doctor, this application for used in factories or small one for
home? It is normally used for high size or big size applications. The system is made up of so many components, so normally it is done or it is economically viable for large systems. That's why if you are talking about, a place like our university, some of the buildings are cooled by vapor compression systems. In these vapor compression systems, we are basically cooling water. So you cool water, you have Freon versus water, you have a compressor, condenser, expansion valve, evaporator system, which is going to produce a cooling effect. You cool the water to temperatures like 6 to 8 degrees centigrade. You bring this water into a building, and in that building, in every floor, you have what we call an air handling unit, where this cold water is circulating and you have air passing through it. air is cooled down, and then this cold air is passing through the offices. So this is one way. The other way, like our main library, it is cooled by an absorption system. So you can have this or that. So this is basically, to answer your question, this is normally associated with large scale installations.
Okay, thank you.
دكتور, السولر تانك بالضبط وش ال what's the function of the solar tank?
Storage.
Storage. Okay.
The problem with the solar is that it sun rises at 5 o'clock. You start having some heating effect at 8 o'clock, and the heating effect is going to be increasing up to noon time, and then it will decrease until it is zero at the sunset, and then yes. After sunset, there's no energy. So you are talking about an energy which is not at a constant value. It is varying, and it is not available after hours. So what you do, you need to make it steady by having some sort of a storage device that will take this energy and release it in a steady base. Another way of utilizing the solar energy is by using the PV panels, the photovoltaics. I'm not sure if you started photovoltaics in some other course this semester. If not, then you are going to have it in details in our next semester. So that there are units that are converting solar energy in the form of light into electric power. They do not have moving parts. However, as of the current technology, they have low efficiency. The efficiency is somewhere between the 20 and 30%. Although they are gallium-based PV panels that have efficiency, which is about 45% or so, but they are so expensive that they are not commercially available, but they are used in space applications. Some of the problems related to the PV panels is collection of dust. Whenever the dust is increased on the surface, then it reduces the light coming in, so the efficiency decreases further. They have another problem with related to temperature. As the temperature increases, as the efficiency decreases, and that's why there are some projects and ideas to be there so that they can cool them effectively so that they maintain good efficiency. And they are working on surface treatment by nanotechnology, so they have a dust repelling surfaces so that the dust does not remain on the surface. Condensation in humid climate does not remain on the surface, but the water rolls down and keeping the surface always clean so that you keep on having good efficiency of this system. The way that it works is that the solar energy hits the surface, releases some of the electrons, leaving a positive charge, whereas the negative charge is taken out in a circuit to go. And that kind of potential difference creates the flow of the solar energy, of the electricity. The electric power here is DC, direct current, and the voltage difference is not much. That's why you need a large number of these solar collectors stacked together so that they can make up the required load that you are looking for. So they convert solar energy into light. We talked about this already, that the issue of, yes, the main idea of operating these units. Solar cells require extended periods of sunshine so that they operate, and a large number of these units are going to be needed. And actually the price of this unit has decreased significantly in the last decade. So now it's a little bit more affordable compared to 10 years ago to have a PV system that's attached to your house to take care of all the load. It's not only that, but in some places you have these units because again, they are going to operate as long as there's a solar energy. What are you going to do with your lighting and your electric needs after sunset? Either use batteries to store the energy, or in some countries, they have what they call a two-way meter. So that what you do is that you have solar collectors, you can generate electricity, and this electricity is going through an inverter to convert it from DC to AC current, and you put it to the grid. And then you extract energy from the grid, and you only pay the difference. So that makes it economically better, and it will save a substantial amount of cost, which is the cost of the battery. Wind energy is another version of the renewable energy which is being utilized, so that if you have direct wind, the higher the speed, the better. The higher the altitude, that's why there is a certain standard altitude to put your wind turbines in, so that they rotate, they are connected with generators, and the generators can produce electricity. Wind energy is a substantial amount of energy that can be produced, but it's not everywhere. There are locations that are having potential of wind energy. UK, for example, is having a very good potential for it. Germany is relying a lot on wind energy. There are areas in the kingdom where wind energy can be substantial. The west coast in the north, this is a very good potential for wind energy. And I think there was some sort of wind atlas that will give you the potential of, or provide the potential of wind energy to be effective in several places. In many, many other installations, they have a combination between solar and wind, to the extent that they came up with solar collectors with integrated vertical blades. What we have here is horizontal wind turbines. There are vertical ones, which are more expensive, definitely, but they are more efficient, and they can respond to low speed of wind so that they can rotate easily and produce substantial amount of energy. So the point here is some solar collectors are integrated as a part of it with vertical wind turbines that can produce energy, and you have a combination of both. This is an example of the vertical wind turbines here. The previous slide has the horizontal ones. The verticals are better, but they are more expensive. The biomass power, this does not apply to us, but this is general. In some places, some countries, they rely on wood, especially in Europe. Canada, they are using wood as a source of energy. And again, the point of the growth of forests should be maintained so that they keep on a constant input quantity of wood that they can use. Basically, it's used for heating in many, many places. This is a potential of the utilization of wood fuel in many, many places throughout the world, and it's being used as a source of energy. So that's basically the kind of biomass that that I meant here. Methane is another potential of to be used as some sort of a natural gas for producing energy. And many houses, for example, in China are using the digesters of the biogas in fermentation manner to produce methane. So it's basically one way to produce fertilizers, and this comes as a byproduct, and they can use it basically, or sometimes they can use some sort of special devices like this fermentation manner, something like an oven, and they use it, they put all the waste of their home use in it, and then after some time, the fermentation of the waste can occur and it can produce methane, and methane can be used as some sort of fuel. Hydropower is another way to look at it, where falling water, whenever you have waterfalls or you have a stream of river which is passing, you can make use of that and put a turbine in the passage of the water, and then you can generate energy. And this is one of the cleanest kind of energy production units throughout the world. But you have to have a river or you have to have a waterfall in order to operate a system like that. This is typically what you can see. And this is why, for example, countries that have rivers are building dams so that they can store a tremendous amount of water behind the dam so that they can make use of a constant flow rate of the water that's going to run their turbines at a constant speed, and then they can generate electricity. Advantages of these are although they need substantial amount of a capital cost, but running cost is very small, it's inexpensive. They do not release any pollution to the surroundings, so they are clear. And they are going to basically have some sort of a sustainable issue, they are going to run all as long as you have enough water level in the dam, then you can operate your system. And you have some sort of benefits of protection of the downstream villages or people, that they protect them from floods, because the floods are basically are having tremendous amount of water, which is going to be stored in the dam, and accordingly it will not adversely affect villages. You have probably heard about floods that are destroying anything on the way, houses, living creatures, either peoples or even animals. The disadvantage is that it can change the way the river is flowing, because they are going to release the amount of water which is suitable for running the turbines. That might not be very suitable for the agriculture life, which is downstream of the dam. And probably you've heard about the issues that the control of the dam, which is being built in Ethiopia, might affect both Sudan and Egypt in terms of the kind of or the flow rate of the water which is supposed to be done while they are filling in the dam. Flooding is one of the problems, that any damage that would happen to the dam is going to result in flooding, and this is substantially is a substantial threat to the people who are living there. The other thing here is that the sediments that are carried by the water, that are basically having a good quality of mud, which is needed for agriculture, this is basically filtered out. And this is one of the problems, that the quality of the land is being affected by holding up this quantity of big quantity of water, which is coming from the mountains with its rich in mineral muds, which are not passing through. You talk about the geothermal energy, where deposits of substantial amount of energy, which are stored below the crust of the earth, that can come out in the form of hot water or even steam. And then you can put your Rankine cycle thermal power plant, making use of that steam, which is coming from the underground. What you need to do, just pass it by turbines, and then you run the turbines and you have electricity. Italy is very rich in having this this kind of energy or geothermal energy to be utilized there. So that's something, again, it depends on locations of the earth where geothermal energy can be found. In the southwest part of the kingdom, there is a potential for geothermal energy. I think it's been considered, but it's not yet fully utilized.
Doctor?
Yes.
Is it possible to utilize the existing oil wells after we suck all the oils to make generate geothermal, or specific areas needed?
No, it needs specific areas, because I mean, the wells that are producing, it's not producing oils that which is or hot enough. This is in one hand. On the other hand, this naturally located places in the world, actually it has some sort of a little cracks on the cracks on the crust of the earth, where automatically you have steam coming out of it. So that's something you don't do much effort in, except that you identify the location and then do the diggings, put your pipe so that at the end of the pipe you have steam coming naturally. Yes.
يعني is there any يعني نقول أي توجه مثلاً to use the advantage of the full cans?
I think there is. Talking about solar or renewable energy in general, all the possibilities are being explored. You can have, even you can find some studies that have been done within the kingdom to identify the potential use of geothermal energy in different applications. Part of it is in power production, part of it in desalination of the water. So there are some studies that are existing here. To what extent have these studies are being converted into some sort of a strategic decision? This is, I'm not really aware of. So is there some plan during the next 5 years to utilize, for example, a certain percentage or making a certain amount of energy coming off geothermal energies. This is, I'm not sure about, I'm not aware of any of these of this kind of plans that are there, but I would assume that they are there.
Doctor, I have one question, please.
Yes.
In general, what are the challenges for the renewable energy? Is it the efficiency of the power that are being created? Is it the maintenance cost? Is it the high investment cost, or what are the challenges?
Actually, there are basically two major elements. One of them is the efficiency associated with these units are still lower than what you get from a fossil fuel. So as long as the fossil fuel is available and available as cheap, then investors will go into it because they are looking for profit. For example, solar energy started to attract attention in the 70s of the previous century because there were some political issues that result in raising the oil price. So people started to invest in solar energy. And then came the 80s and the 90s and the oil price becomes economical. So people left the funding of the research in solar energy and they started using fossil fuels right away. And then at the last part of the 90s, when people started to worry about the environmental effects, they started to revisit the solar energy again. And then a lot of investments in terms of research and improvements of the system has come in. So again, if they continued working with the solar energy steadily from the 70s onward, probably now we could have units that are more efficient. So efficiency is one issue. The second major issue is the initial cost of these units. Basically, you are not paying for the solar energy, but you are paying for the solar devices that you have to install in your system to convert the solar energy into useful energy. And you have to pay for the land that will be utilized for putting these. So this is basically a major concern that something, the prices of these units, the technology has to improve the performance so that you have higher efficiencies. And that's something that we are seeing. They started actually from an efficiency of 7%, and now are reaching to something in the middle of the 20%. There exists one technology, I talked about the gallium-based PV panels that can produce an efficiency about 45%. This is typically like a power plant, but the price is enormously high that it can be used for commercial scale. And people are still working on that so that they can have either new materials or enhancing of the materials, or maybe going into the issue from the PV to the concentrated power PV so that they can work on having systems that are more efficient and less costly. And this is going to make it more beneficial. Some people or some countries actually, in order to make use of the solar energy effectively, or to encourage people to use solar energy, they do a couple of things. Number one, doing incentives. In the US, if you are going to utilize solar energy for your house, at least for water heating, then you have a tax cut. Some other places, Turkey, for example, if you need to put solar energy, they give you the solar component free. So it is this kind of incentives that are given from one hand. On the other hand, they increase the price of the fuel. We did a study to the Ministry of Electricity and Water before they split it. It was something like we started it 5 or 6 years ago. It was talking about the replacement of diesel heating for water in the service sector, in hospitals and hotels, to heat the water by solar energy. And some of the things that we were looking at was the price of fuel. Some of them are using diesel to generate or to heat the water, like a diesel burner. And the burner is going to heat the water and use the hot water to heat the rooms of the hotels or rooms in the hospitals. So they are going to use diesel. Diesel, actually, the price here is less than 1/13 of its price worldwide. So some of the incentives would probably is to waive part of this total cost of installation of the units. And another part is to make the diesel a little bit more expensive so that the solar energy becomes like a viable sort of option for the owners to consider it. I hope I answered your question.
Yes, thank you, Dr. Really appreciate it.
Yes, other question?
Sorry for the interruption.
No interruption, go ahead, please.
Thank you. So going back to the geothermal energy, when we take this steam out of the earth,
yes,
is there any issues, side effects, like maybe seismics or something will happen?
Actually, yes. But if you are talking about, it depends on what you are going to take. Because sometimes you take steam and all you need to do is just that steam will be vapor, and vapor is pure. So you take and you put it to the turbine. You just need something like a net or a filter or so. But sometimes what you are getting is not steam, but you are getting hot water. And the hot water that comes, it's not only water, but it's coming with so many other ingredients and minerals. So what you need to do is maybe flash it so that you can get some steam out of it, but it needs a lot of filtration so that you can get rid of this, of any other components that are mixed with the water which is coming. So now it depends what you are getting. Are you getting steam or are you getting hot water? Getting steam is better, but it's not in our hand. That's something, it depends on the nature of the fluid which is coming out of this geothermal location. The renewable energy share in general can be seen here, and how the share has been developing over the decades from the 90s to the beginning of this century to the beginning of the last decades. And you can see there is some sort of an increase. And again, it was depending on the atlas of hydroelectric, geothermal, biomass, solar energy, and wind, and how the investments are being done so that you can have more dependence of these units with as the time passes. What we need to get into now is something about like looking closer to the solar energy as a main source of energy. You know, solar energy is to be relied on in the next period a lot throughout the whole world, including the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia. Solar energy is making a big pillar of the 2030 vision. We're basically looking at solar as an alternative sort of energy. The kingdom is rich in solar energy. It has a total area of about 2.25 million square kilometers. And as you have seen, that most of the year we are having a good portion of solar energy coming in, making use of this solar energy to power many, many of our required applications is something which needs to be further utilized on. The utilization of solar energy or the fraction of solar energy dependence that we have is much less than what the potential that it has. To begin with, although there's a large different distance between Earth and the Sun, but there's an enormous solar energy which is reaching the Earth. If you look at outside the atmosphere, the quantity of energy which is reaching from the solar energy is something like 1.368 kilowatt per cubic meter, per square meter. This is what's called at the solar constant. This is the amount of solar which is reaching always at the outside of the atmosphere. Although we call it a solar constant, it's not really a constant, but it is it's something that varies according to how the distance between the Earth and the water and the Sun is changing, and the orientation of the Earth as well. So, but anyway, this is the kind of the variation is something that does not exceed 4%. So we're talking about a substantial amount of energy which is falling outside or reaching outside of the atmosphere. Once it comes to the atmosphere, part of it is being absorbed, a part of it is being retracted, and what we are getting is like 4 kilowatt hour per cubic meter in average.
Doctor?
Yes.
Yeah, when we coming to the solar energy and the sun, I saw a very nice video talking about entropy and the sun energy. It is not like finite energy, it is limited. I don't know what is the exact relationship between the entropy and the sun. Can you
can you share that video for us so that we can have a look at it first and then we can comment on it?
See if yes.
You think for it, please share it with us. Maybe you can put it on in the blackboard or can send it by the email, and then I'll look at it and then we can discuss this issue.
Okay, thank you.
So the amount of solar energy which is intercepted by the Earth that the Earth is receiving in a month is basically equivalent to all the energy stored by any conventional means on the planet. So what this statement says, it says that there's a great potential of utilization of the solar energy if we design our units and systems so that they can make use of that energy appropriately. There is some sort of a famous relation that says that it's called the inverse square law, that the irradiation is reduced proportional to the inverse square of a distance from the source. You can make use of that with solar energy coming in, or even you can make use of that locally if you have like a local source and you need to determine what is the distance at which the receiver should be in comparison with that source. Now there's a couple of definitions here. One of them is what we call the irradiance. The irradiance means the solar energy falling per unit area, whereas the integration of this irradiance is what we call the solar irradiation, or the irradiation. Sometimes we refer to the radiation as capital G. It depends from one source or one book to the other, but it's basically how much energy as watt per meter square is falling or received by the surface over a certain period of time. So it's some sort of an integration to the irradiance over a portion of time. Now, the daily solar constant that I just mentioned, there is a relation that controls this value, or that is used to evaluate or estimate how much is the solar constant falling. And this actually is related to the number of the day. By the number of the day, I mean throughout the year, we have N is equal to 1 in the 1st of January, and then N is equal to 365 at the 31st of December. And we are going to use capital N here along our coverage of the introduction to the solar energy a lot. So this is a number that we are going to need. For example, if I'm going to talk about a certain condition in the mid of February, then mid of February is going to be 15th of February plus 31, that makes the day number 46 of the year. If I'm talking about 1st of July, then I have to count the days from January 1 up to the 1st of July and see what's the value of N. So it's a value that varies from 1 to 365. And the relation that you have in front of you is determining or estimating the daily solar constant as it changes from one day to the other. And the relation is being given here as a function of the order of the day throughout the year. Why it is N minus 3 in the parenthesis? Because basically 3rd of January is the day where they call it the solar perihelion. The solar perihelion is basically, it is the day of the year where the Earth is closest to the sun. On the other hand, there's another definition, which is other than the perihelion. They call it, let me recall the name. I think the, I'll be coming into that, which is the day, on the other hand, which is the Earth is very, it is in the farthest location from the sea, from the sun. The average insolation, the word insolation here, we're talking about the energy falling from the sun to the Earth per square meter. So the average insolation reaching the Earth is less than the amount outside the atmosphere. We said outside the atmosphere, we call it the solar constant. But as it gets into the atmosphere, there is absorption by the clouds. There is refraction due to the aerosols and dust particles that are going to emit back part of the energy. So what you are getting to the Earth's surface is less than this quantity.
Dr. Antal, so after the 3rd of January, the sun goes tibta'id 'an al-ard?
Yes, it keeps on going far until the 21st of or around 21st of December, not December, it's somewhere in June, July, and then it comes closer again. I think it's 4th of July, 3rd of January and 4th of July. One of them is the Earth is very close.
And one of them very far.
Closest to the sun, and it's farthest in 4th of July.
Okay.
So above the atmosphere, we get this quantity, the solar constant, 1368 watt per meter squared of radiation. Across all wavelengths, this number varies between plus or minus 3% because of either the distance or because of the kind of flares that are occurring at the surface of the sun. Scattering in the ground is making a lot of effect by reducing this quantity substantially by a quantity of maybe you can get something like 63% if you are lucky of 850 watt per meter square with no clouds on a perpendicular surface. And it could be a little bit higher if we are talking about a dry desert condition, because the water vapor in the atmosphere works on absorbing part of the energy and refracting part of it as well. So what is going to go through and reach the surface of the Earth is usually considerably less than the solar constant, which is reaching at the outside of the atmosphere. This figure here is giving us this kind of sense that the solar irradiation, which is reaching by 100%, there is a substantial amount here which is being related to the clouds, which represents something like 52%, whereas the 48 is being affected by the atmosphere, by whether it is aerosols or dust particles in the atmosphere. Now, if you're talking about the clouds, clouds are basically absorbing 10% of this solar energy. They are upscattering, like reflecting 25%, and the remainder, which is 17%, is diffused to the down from the clouds. Whereas the direct solar, which is coming, well, part of it is absorbed, 9%, part is down scattered from the atmosphere, and part is upscattered from the atmosphere upward. So actually, that's why not all of it, which is reaching the upper part of the atmosphere is reaching to us, but due to either clouds or aerosols, this quantity that we receive is considerably less. This is some sort of a quantification to what we have seen in the previous figure. 50% is hitting the clouds, and 40% does not hit the clouds and they pass through. In the cloudless conditions, half of that 48% is direct, whereas from the clouds about 30, so total of 33 is reaching to the ground. And then in cloudy conditions, the clouds are absorbing part, we are receiving only 33 out of it. So this basically, this slide is related to this figure that you hear, and then you can quantify the numbers, like you can count what, how much we are getting from here and there, and you can see substantially how much energy that we are receiving, which is basically coming from the sun. This is not constant, but it depends on whether we have cloudy areas or not, and what is the condition in terms of relative humidity or humidity or air water particles that are suspended in the air, and the aerosols that are there in the air and the dust particles. All of these basically are reducing the kind of energy which is falling from the sun. That's sort of a continuation. We're talking about the amount of light which is received by horizontal surface in watt per meter square is averaged through the years. This is called the insolation, as we mentioned. We can make a guess based on half of the incident energy is reaching to the ground. It is basically half of the time is a day and the rest is a night. And the sun itself is not always overhead. So sometimes the area have some sort of a change. So at the end, we are talking about typically 1/8 of the distant sunlight is typically available at the ground, which is on the average 171. In some places, it is much higher than the 171. In other places, it's much lower, depending on whether we have cloud cover, do we have latitude. For example, a place in the Sahara, which is always sunny, close to the equator, it can get an average of 270 watt per meter square. Whereas in Alaska, it goes down to 75. And by average here, I mean we are considering both day and night. So sometimes it's higher than that, and sometimes it is zero. So on the average, this is the kind of energy that can be intercepted in a location like Sahara and a location like Alaska. And that's why there are places that are hot and places that are cold. This is the spectrum over which the solar energy is coming. Part of the solar energy is received in the ultraviolet scale. Part of it is coming in the visible range of light, and part is coming through the infrared. And this is related to how much is the wavelength. Yes, go ahead, please.
But he's waiting to enter the...
Oh, so maybe he left and he's joining again. Yes. So thank you for directing attention. So this is a part here. For example, some of the problems that we used to provide for students who are studying heat transfer when we come to the radiation is just to ask them how much is the energy from the sun is coming in the visible light range, and some of them are coming in the infrared range, some how much is coming in the ultraviolet range. And this is all related to the wavelength that represents the ultraviolet scale, the visible light, and the infrared wavelength. This is some geographical information on the potential of solar radiation in the US. Here values are given, some values or some places are having a range which is less than 138 watt per meter square, and some other places are having a range of greater than 231 watts per meter square. I'm talking about the average as well. And the darker is the areas that are receiving more solar energy. And you can see here that the west or the southwest part of the state is the one which is receiving more energy, more solar energy. And that's why, no wonder why many of these solar applications can be found in California and Nevada, for example, in so this area as the one that has highest impact of solar energy.
But Doctor, which range shall we use? The one on the left or the one under the drawing?
The one on the left here is the one that represented higher potential. It does not mean that you cannot use it in other places.
لا دكتور أنا قصدي في السلايد اللي قبلها الأرقام مختلفة في الأريز يعني هذا مثلاً less than 138 watt per meter squared نفسها طالعة في الرسمة 3.32 kilowatt per meter squared.
This is watt per meter square. This is kilowatt hour per meter square. So this is integrated with the time.
Okay.
So for example, how much is for example this is 138 watt per meter square. And for example, if there's 138 as an average for 6 hours, then you multiply the 138 by the 6 hours, then you get it in kilowatt hour per meter square. Okay. This is showing the solar resource for a concentrating collector. Again, the kind of potential in terms of how much watt hour per square meter in different places is being specified here. I was looking for similar information which are related to the kingdom, and then this is actually what I got from, I'm sharing the source where I got the information here. Maybe in the next slide you'll see it. But it's talk about an average of solar radiation that varies from a maximum of around 7 kilowatt hour per meter square at Bisha, and a minimum of 4.479 kilowatt hour per meter square in Tabuk. The higher values of the solar radiation are observed in most part of the southern region of the country, like Bisha, Najran, and Sulayl. We have a global horizontal irradiation of a certain high range here, which is in the desert is higher than in the coastal areas, which means that we're going to have a good performance of the photovoltaic technologies at any location, although that, again, when you are talking about higher solar energy, we are talking about extremely higher temperatures. And as the temperature increases, the performance of the PV panels decrease. And something needs to be done. And so many of the patents and the research ideas that came here so that they can do sort of effective cooling for the PV panels so that they can operate in a better better way, although the temperature is high. So we're talking about the global horizontal irradiation. Down here, we have the direct normal irradiation with a range of 4400 up to 7,300 watt hour per meter square, where the highest values are given for the clear skies. So there's an important issue here to consider, which is the kind of energy which is being utilized by solar collectors that are used for heating are basically, we are looking for sort of a diffuse energy, because the energy which are falling into it, whether it's a combination of incident light or diffused energy, both of these are resulting in a heating effect. But for PV panels, basically you need something like direct normal energy falling into it. And that's why the part of clearer sky is the part which is more relevant to utilization of the PV panels. Solar radiation information in the kingdom has been given here, that the west part of the kingdom is suitable for concentrated solar power with a total of 6,400 watt hour per meter square, whereas the eastern province or the eastern area is also suitable for concentrated solar, but the average is a little bit less than the west, which means that in the west, the performance of these units can be a little bit better than what we have here, because they are basically receiving more energy on the average. I put the slide down there where you can get details of this information, talking about the photovoltaic power potential in the kingdom. And it seems that the better location for the photovoltaics here is toward the northwestern part of the kingdom. This is where the sky is clearer, and that's basically around Tabuk. Whereas the global horizontal irradiation, total irradiation horizontal or global horizontal is on the west side. So this is where you can put your thermal units, and the east side again, but it has a little bit of a less potential compared into that. And that's again, the direct normal radiation is highest here. And then there's an estimation of the average daily direct normal irradiation falling into several locations. And the locations here are identified by geographical locations. For example, Haqqal and Tawuk are going to have the highest, and the lowest are going to be somewhere here in like Wadi Dawasir or so. Is it the lowest? Yes, it appears to me. It's not low. I mean, we are talking about values that are between 5,800 and 6,000 watt per hour meter square, but relatively speaking, it's a little bit lower. And for example, Al-Qunfida here, which is south of Jeddah, is going to have, is that the lowest as it appears to me here in terms of direct DNI or direct normal irradiation. So there is, I remember in early in the 90s, there was a big project in the kingdom, which is called the Solar Atlas. And it has been released and then updated. So it's a very large, when it was paper-based, it was some sort of a very large and heavy file that has what's called the Solar Atlas. It has all the information about temperatures, wind, solar energy, and it has been given on an hourly basis or the average daily or average monthly or average yearly. So all of this kind of information have been working. There's some sort of climatic stations that are located in the kingdom, and these climatic stations are producing lots of the information, and the information are being integrated together to make up this kind of detailed atlas information. Abdurrahman, tfaddal, you have a question?
I know that currently King Abdullah City for Atomic and Renewable Energy, it's working to update that atlas because initially it was produced by them. So they are now working on the updating.
Before we come into the picture, because I remember there was a project in our research institute here at KFUPM in 1993, and they produced the first version of the atlas. Now the whole world, the whole work is under the jurisdiction of CACAIR. They have lots of this information in their websites. If you just look into the website, you can sign up, and then you can just get this kind of information in details. So they have even information region by region that you can get it from there. You cannot get it as integrated information in any other place. You can find scattered information, but they are the entity that brought all the info together, and they are working on updating it based on their responsibility. But it has started earlier than that.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, you're almost welcome. And these are basically some of this information here of that has been reported in terms of the summary of solar irradiation over a year. That's a study that has been done. And the results of this study is being given here. This has been published by people in CACAIR, basically. And it's talking about different locations in the kingdom and the potential of average daily total or global irradiation or normal irradiation, and whether it is on a daily basis or other than daily basis, like monthly or so, and whether they are talking about average or maximum values. All over the world, the insulation or the average annual insulation in some different countries is being shown here. And you can see here that there's a big change as you are going from one place to the other. Small values like in Seattle and Tokyo, whereas high values are there for Cairo, for Johannesburg, for Mumbai. Unfortunately, this kind of table does not have the information in Saudi Arabia, but I'm sure that this information is there. In some cities worldwide, the insulation values have been given. Winter values, as you can see it in a figure like this, they are comparing the winter values versus summer values. Definitely summer values are higher than the winter values. Whether we are talking about, is it a megajoule per square meter per day, or the hours of sunshine through the day, and both are related. The higher the sunshine hours, the higher than the value which is being intercepted or received by the sun. And the general comments have been given here that the winter values are lower than the summer values generally, due to shorter days in the winter and longer days in summer. So it is related to the sunshine hours. Places that are closer to the equator give closer seasonal values. The monsoon rains, which is places in the world where they have higher humidity, they have much of the energy gained is by diffuse radiation. By diffuse, what I mean is that they receive radiation and they refracted in several directions. So at the end, you have several rays that are coming, and because they have been diffused away by some of these, either the particles of the rain or by the aerosols. Insulation changes during a day on a year based, and it depends again on the altitude and how much clear is the sky to allow for the solar energy to pass. This is direct information of direct normal versus horizontal insulation at an altitude of 32. I checked what is the altitude of 32 within the kingdom. I found that Toreif is the one which is having this kind of altitude in general. Otherwise, the altitude is, I think it's somewhere between that 23rd to 26. But this is one of the north latitudes in the kingdom, And this information was not made to Tarif, but I wrote Tarif here in red because its altitude is somewhere close to 32. And for example, how throughout the years, the values of the radiation is changing between day and night. Whereas in a very high altitude, like in 48 north, the values are given by this figure. I think that both figures are being used for some sort of a comparison, that the variations within the day and the variation from season to season can be seen and compared between them. Actually, I was planning for, I think, a break, but it's a little bit coming in few slides. So maybe you can wait just for about 4 to 5 slides before we get into the breaks. Or maybe if you wish, we can just have it as early as now, because I noticed that we have been like 1 hour and 5 to 10 minutes going. So maybe you can start having a coffee break now, and then you can continue in 10 minutes. Will that be okay?
Yes, Dr. Yes.
Thank you, Dr.
Dr. Muhammad.
اتفضل. Yes.
اتفضلك. عندي سؤال جانبي. بالنسبة لمشروع سد النهضة. ليش من الأساس مصر وافقت عليه إذا هي عارفة والآن رفضت بعد ما تم بناءه إنه أثيوبيا أظن تقفله أو ما نعرف المشكلة بالضبط، بس قصدي ليش تم البناء البداية في البناء فيه وافقت عليه بعدين صار في تراجع أو شيء؟
It is.